hear about it.
Good morning, Miss.
Morning, Miss Brodie.
Oh, good morning, Miss Limehouse. Miss Lime.
Oh, will you put that hand up?
Yes, Miss Brodie.
Put that on the desk.
Yes, Miss Brodie.
Adequate. More is vulgar, forsooth. One should have an innate sense of these things, of what is suitable. More egg, will you please? Thank you. I see we have two new girls this term. Will the two new girls please stand up? You are?
Emily Carstairs, Miss Brodie.
Emily Carstairs. There. You are inscribed. Would you like to tell us something about yourself, Emily?
I'm a girl guide, Miss Brodie. I have 6 merit badges. One for knot tying, one for flag folding.
Indeed. For those who like that sort of thing, that is the sort of thing they like. You may sit down, Emily. And this is Mary McGregor. Well, what about you, Mary? You don't look to me like a girl who ties knots.
No, Miss Brodie, but my brother does.
That is as it should be. But what about you? What are your interests?
I haven't got any. I don't think.
That is what I am for, Mary McGregor. To provide you with interests. You may sit down now, Mary.
little girls. I am in the business of putting old heads on young shoulders, and all my pupils are the creme de la creme. Give me a girl at an impressionable age, and she is mine for life. You girls are my vocation. If I were to receive a proposal of marriage tomorrow from the Lord Lion, King of Arms, I would decline it. I am dedicated to you in my prime. And my summer in Italy has convinced me that I am truly in my prime. Emily, Mary MacGregor, you are new to this institution. It is possible you will hear my teaching methods decried in certain quarters as being unsuitable for a conservative school like Marcia Blaine. That is to say, a school dedicated to the status quo. Can anyone define the status quo? Sandy?
Does it mean staying the same, Miss Brodie?
Precisely. Staying the same to the point of petrification. P-E-T-R-I-F-I-C-A-T-I-O-N. Petrification. I do not intend to devote my prime to petrification. Prop up your books in case of intruders. If there are intruders, we are doing our history. But we will not do our history. Can anyone tell me who is the greatest Italian painter?
Leonardo da Vinci, Miss Brodie.
That is incorrect, Jenny. The answer is Giotto. He is my favorite. Observe, little girl, Stanley Baldwin, who got in as Prime Minister and got out again ere long. Our headmistress, Miss Mackay, retains him on the walls because she believes in the slogan safety first. But safety does not come first. Goodness, truth, and beauty come first. One's prime brings one's insight into these things. One's prime is the moment one is born for. You little girls must be on the alert to recognize your prime at whatever time it may occur and live it to the full. Season of mist and mellow fruitfulness. I want to tell you of a moment in my life when I was very young, younger even than the man himself. His name was Hugh. I fell deeply in love with Hugh in the last year of the war, but he fell on Flanders Field. Helen McPhee, are you thinking of doing a day's washing?
No, Miss Brodie.
You have your sleeves rolled up. Roll them down at once. I won't have to do with girls who roll up the sleeves of their blouses. We are civilized beings. He fell on Flanders Field. He fell the week before armistice was declared. He fell like an autumn leaf. Remind me to show you a map of Flanders and the spot where my lover was laid to sleep forever before you were born. Come autumn, sit pensive in yellow and grey, and soothe me with tidings of nature's decay. Robert Burns. Hugh fell like an autumn leaf. After the armistice, people were dancing and singing for joy in the streets, but Hugh was one of the flowers of the forest, lying in his grave.
Well, it seems to be ailing the spirits of Monica McLaren, isn't it?
Monica cries easily.
Well, Monica, perhaps you can tell me why you are crying.
She's moved by a story I have been telling of the Battle of Flodden.
Crying over a history lesson?
It is a moving story. The night before Flodden at Mercat Cross beside St. Giles, a ghostly herald was heard reading the names of all the noble families of Scotland, beginning with the king. After the battle, there was not one family who had not suffered grievous loss, as you well know, Miss Mackay.
To be sure. Well, girls, I know you're all going to work hard at every subject this year. A good beginning makes a good ending. I hope you all had splendid holidays. And I look forward to reading your splendid essays on how you spent them. You shouldn't be crying over a history lesson at your age. My word. Thank you, Janet.
Good morning, Miss Mackay. You may sit down, girls.
You did well, Monica, not to answer the question put to you. It is well when in difficulties to say never a word, neither black nor white.
But you did, Miss Brodie. You were in difficulty and you made up about Flodden.
Sandy, please try to do as I say and not as I do. Remember, you are a child, Sandy, and far from your prime. Congratulate you on the birth of another child.
Yes, another daughter.
Have you never heard of Mary Stopes, architect for constructive birth control and racial progress?
Ah, yes, an estimable woman. But you see, my church enjoins me to go forth and be fruitful.
I am aware of your unfortunate affiliation with the Church of Rome. I doubt, however, whether that body gives the same interpretation to go forth that you do.
My church understands human imperfection and forgives it. Why can't you?
I am not interested in human imperfection. I am interested in beauty, in art, in truth.
In art and beauty, maybe. In truth, no.
This is outrageous.
The truth, Jean, is that you bounced into bed with an artist, but you were horrified when you woke up with a man.
Release me instantly.
I finished your portrait, Jean. Come back to the studio. Come, son.
I can't.
Why not?
I have another engagement.
Well, break it.
I can't possibly. I'm going to Claremont.
What for?
Mr. Lowther has invited me to his estate at Claremont.
Lowther?
He has a small boat. I'm invited to go sailing. On Sunday.
What do you want me to do? Ravish you on the floor for the edification of your girls?
Is this liver paste, Miss Brodie?
It is pâté de foie gras.
Pâté de foie gras. Oh, it must be marvellous to be French.
Well, the French have a genius for food, but I doubt French women will ever get the vote.
I was quite emphatic about it.
I'll not pull my punches, Miss Mackay, I said. Miss Brodie's girls are different.
Oh, you said that.
Oh, I said it all right. And I meant it. Thank you, Miss Lockhart. The Brodie set, indeed. We girls refusing to wash their faces. Oh, Miss Brodie, they informed me, hasn't washed her face in 20 years.
She looks clean enough from here.
Miss Brodie prescribes cold cream.
She always looks so extreme.
This is my new girl, Mr. Lowther, Mary McGregor. Mr. Lowther, there's a great deal Mr. Lowther can teach you about the modulation of your tone.
Oh. Miss Brodie, I thought... that is, I hoped there might be time for a wee cup of tea in the common room before the afternoon classes.
Oh... How nice of you to ask me, Mr. Lowther. Now, girls, I leave Mary McGregor in your charge. Thank you.
Well, Mary McGregor, how much pocket money do you get?
1 and 6 a week.
1 and 6? Your father gives you 1 and 6.
Mr. Ealing gives it to me. I don't have a father or mother.
Who's Mr. Ealing?
At the bank. He's our guardian. He takes care of the money.
Well, I'd like to be an orphan heiress and get my pocket money from bankers that don't know any better. Does your brother get 1 and 6 too?
I don't know. He's 14. My brother has run away from 4 schools.
Your brother sounds like a bad lot.
So I thought that this Sunday I would treat myself to one last day of sun and water. I wonder, Mr. Lowther, if you might be able to help me.
In what way, Miss Brodie?
Well, you might know if there's any possibility of my renting a little boat at Cremon.
Oh, but Miss Brodie, I have a boat.
Oh, do you, Mr. Lowther?
Oh, it would give me the greatest pleasure. I mean, if you would consider coming with me.
Oh, but I couldn't trouble you, Mr. Lowther.
Trouble? Oh, Miss Brodie, I would have asked you before many times, but I didn't want to seem to push myself. Please, Miss Brodie, say you'll come with me.
Very well, Mr. Lowther. On Sunday?
On Sunday. After church, of course.
Oh, of course, Mr. Lowther. Grazie, Tendra.
Do you think Mr. Lloyd is the creme de la creme, or Mr. Lowther?
Neither. It's us. Little girls, if you will only listen to me, I will make of you the creme de la creme.
My father says these are the happiest days of our lives. But if these are supposed to be the happiest, why does Miss Brodie say prime is best?
Miss Brodie never got married like our mothers and fathers. They don't have primes.
They have sexual intercourse.
Oh, I don't like to think about it.
You don't have to think about it. It happens on the spur of the moment.
You lead.
How do you know?
Know what?
What you were saying. About how sexual intercourse happens on the spur of the moment.
Because it happened to Teeny, that works in her father's shop, when she was out walking at Paddocky with her boyfriend. They had to get married.
You'd think that the urge would have passed by the time they'd got their clothes off.
Yes. That's what I can't understand. People take their clothes off in front of each other. It's so rude. They're bound to be put off their passion.
Miss Brodie ever had sexual intercourse with Hugh of Flanders Field before he fell?
I don't know.
I don't think they did anything like that. Their love was above all that.
Well, Miss Brodie said they clung to each other with passionate abandon on his last leave.
I don't think they took their clothes off, though. Do you?
No, I can't see it.
Observe, little girls, the castle. It is built on a rock, a volcanic plug. It was through one of yon windows that Mary, Queen of Scots, lowered her infant son straight down 187 feet in a basket in a high wind. Mary MacGregor, will you please do up your shoelace? Observe the litter. In Italy, Mussolini has put an end to litter in the streets. Do any of you little girls remember what the followers of Mussolini are called?
Fascisti.
That is correct. F-A-S-C-I-S-T-I, fascisti. And Mussolini is called?
Duce.
Il Duce. That is to say the leader, Il Duce. We move on. Straighten your shoulders, Mary MacGregor. All you girls must learn to walk with your heads up. Like Sybil Thorndyke. A woman of noble mien. In the Kirk of the Grey Friars, on the 28th day of February, 1638, the people of Scotland pledged themselves to the Presbyterian faith. Many of them use their own blood to sign the covenant. Ugh. Oh, this part of Edinburgh is very rich in history. It is very romantic. Citizens of Edinburgh, city of Hume and Boswell. You are Europeans, not dowdy provincials. Sandy, what on earth are you doing?
Walking like Sybil Thorndyke, Miss Brodie.
Do you know, one day, Sandy, one day, you will go too far.
Hello.
Oh, Mr. Lloyd. Girls, you know Mr. Lloyd, the art master from the senior school.
Yes.
Yes.
Good afternoon, girls.
Mr. Lloyd has his studio somewhere in this neighbourhood, I believe.
Number 6, fourth floor front. Door's always open.
I've been giving my girls an outing. We've been to the gallery. I've been telling them the story of Gauguin.
Ah, the dangerous Miss Brodie.
By whom, pray, am I considered to be dangerous?
It is the consensus. Your girls are said to be vastly informed in subjects irrelevant to the accepted curriculum. Most heinous of all, you are said to inculcate no team spirit. Is that true, girls? Does Miss Brodie incite you to shirk your duties on the hockey field?
Phrases like the team spirit are always employed to cut across individualism. Cleopatra knew nothing of the team spirit, if you read your Shakespeare. And where would the team spirit have got Anna Pavlova? She is the prima ballerina. It is the corps de ballet that have the team spirit.
Oh, Miss Brodie, you are dangerous.
Yes, well, we must away and catch our tram. I doubt we will get seats. It is 1932 and chivalry is dead.
Miss Brodie, I do want you to come and see the picture, the one I told you about. What about next weekend?
No, I'm afraid I'm going to...
Going to Crammond?
Why, yes. My girls and I spend nearly every weekend at Crammond. Mr. Lowther is most hospitable. Good afternoon, Mr. Lloyd. Come along, girls.
Got it. Here we are. Oh, there's some nice ones up here now.
Not get one, we've been
lower
down.
I'm watching, it's all right.
Oh, okay.
His legs are longer than Mr. Lowther's. She'd have to wrap hers around his. First he puts out the light, then their toes touch, then Miss Brodie says, darling, she says, Mr. Lowther, you are the creme de la creme. We will have to watch Miss Brodie's stomach.
It is the curve I am attempting to introduce you to. The curve here, in this drape, and here in the arm. The curve flows through a painting like a river. It is sinuous, sensuous, epitomizing everything that is female. The curve is a beckoning line. Here and here. And here in the breast. And the belly and the buttocks. Shut up. Go on, get along with you. Go to your sewing classes and your singing lessons. It's all you deserve.
Oh,
Flee from me who once did seek me out. I miss you, Jean. Shall I beg you? Please, come back.
You have a family. I am a teacher.
I had a family last June. You were a teacher last June. My God, I wish I had a pound note for every time I've heard you say, I am a teacher. I am a teacher, first, last, and always. What a firm reminder your postcard was. A postcard from romantic Italy. The incomparable Giotto frescoes. How triumphantly his figures vibrate with life. Yours truly, J. Brodie. A postcard from my passionate, abandoned inamorata. That night at the studio. That one night at the studio. I was pleased to feel that it was I who enjoyed the tutorial position. Come back, Jean. I need you.
Shriveled into darkness in his head and dropped before him.
Poor old Tom. Don't worry, Jean. You've got your girls well trained. You're safe enough from that quarter. It's me you've got to worry about. Come to the studio. Come to pose again. Only to pose.
You should be in front of my girls. Jenny is the pretty one.
Hang your girls. It's you I want to pay.
I will not come to the studio.
Then to hell with you.
Daddy, you know, you really should paint Jenny. You like Jenny. She has a profile of deceptive purity.
What's the matter with you, Mary? What's happened to you? Your face is all funny.
No, it's not.
Yes, it is, Mary. Very funny. So's your voice.
Well, well. Miss Brodie's brood, I presume.
Yes, Mr. Lloyd. Would you like a rosebud?
A what?
It's the favorite sweet of little Princess Margaret Rose.
Unmistakably, Brodie. And you, I suppose, are the pretty one. Good afternoon, girls.
Mary, you're definitely upset about something.
No.
Tell. Tell or I'll pinch you.
Tell.
No, I... won't tell. I love Miss Brodie and I won't tell.
What about Miss Brodie? Tell or we'll take you into the locker room and hang you over the banisters.
You wouldn't dare.
Tell.
It's none of your...
We'll drop you squish on your silly head.
Mary, dear, if something's happened with Miss Brodie, you should tell me. What have you done?
She was so angry.
Well, you know how you are, Mary. What have you done now?
Nothing. I just went in.
In where?
The classroom.
So?
There they were.
There who were?
Oh, Mr. Lowther. Miss Brodie and Mr. Lowther.
No.
Mr. Lloyd, they were kissing!
Kissing!
I saw them kissing.
Together?
He had his arms around her.
Mr. Lloyd!
Mr. Lloyd! Mr. Lloyd's in love with Miss Brodie.
And she's in love with Mr. Lloyd. You should have seen
Sam.
But what about Mr. Lowther, then?
Mr. Lloyd is an artist, and Miss Brodie's artistic, too. Miss Brodie's really in love with Mr. Lloyd, but he's married to another. So she's working it off on Mr. Lowther.
Oh!
Let's go home. Listen, Mary. Was it a long lingering kiss?
I shouldn't have told you.
But since you did, was it a long lingering kiss?
Yes.
I see. Didn't they hear you?
I don't think so. They jumped apart, though.
You mean they sensed your presence?
I don't know.
Was it like this?
5 o'clock, time you girls were away. What were you doing, Sandy?
Just play acting, Miss Mackay.
Play acting at what?
Opera.
Opera?
Yes, Miss Mackay. We've been studying Traviata.
Sandy, show me what you were doing. Go on, show me. That's enough, Sandy.
She was doing Violetta, expiring for love of Alfredo. It's very sad.
Oh, nonsense. Violetta did not expire for love of Alfredo. Violetta was a thoroughly silly woman with diseased lungs. If she'd been properly brought up, she'd have been out on the hockey field breathing deeply. Which is precisely what you little girls should be doing. Traviata is not on the Marcia Blaine curriculum.
But Miss Brodie and Mr. Lowther took us to see Traviata when the Carl Rosa Company came to Edinburgh.
Miss Brodie and Mr. Lowther took you to the opera?
Mr. Lowther's jolly nice. We go to visit him at Cramon, too. When Miss Brodie goes, on weekends.
How very nice of Mr. Lowther. And Miss Brodie, I hope you're appreciative. My. Aye. Miss Brodie's very musical, I believe. Theatres, concerts, and the opera. Miss Brodie is very musical.
I think Miss Brodie's more interested in art, Miss Mackay.
Now, what makes you think Miss Brodie prefers art to music, Sandy?
She told us so. Music is an interest to her, but painting is a passion. Miss Brodie said.
A passion?
Compared to music.
Well, Mary, I'm sure you're too young to have passions. What are your cultural interests?
Stories.
Does Miss Brodie tell you stories?
Oh, yes. Lovely stories.
Stories like Traviata?
Stories of history.
History?
She makes history seem like the cinema.
No, not the cinema, more like Shakespeare.
Shakespeare?
Indeed. My, what would we do without Miss Brodie? I could wish your arithmetic papers were better. Culture is no compensation for lack of hard knowledge. I'm happy to see you are devoted to Miss Brodie. Your loyalty is also due to the school. I am always impressed by Miss Brodie's girls. In one way or another,
Benito Mussolini is a great man. He began life as a journalist, a man of learning, an intellectual, but he is also a man of action. He has made Capri into a sanctuary for birds, a simple act of goodness. Now, if you all turn to page 25 of your geography books, you'll find a map of Capri. It's off the coast of Naples. It is because of Il Duce thousands of birds live and sing there today that might well have ended their careers on a piece of toast. Miss Gaunt, is there something you wanted? Thank you. Dear Miss Brodie, I hope it will be convenient for you to see me in my office this afternoon at 4:15, Emmeline Mackay. 4:15, not 4, not 4:30, but 4:15. She thinks to intimidate me by the use of quarter hours. Now, as I was attempting to say, Benito Mussolini is indeed a man of action.
Come in.
4:15. I was afraid I might be late or early.
Not at all. You are most punctilious. Thank you for finding the time. I know how busy your girls keep you. Please sit down.
Oh, thank you.
What a colorful frock.
Colour enlivens the spirit, does it not?
Yes, you're right, though. I sometimes wonder if the spirits of the girls need enlivening.
Oh, indeed, they do. My credo is lift, enliven, stimulate.
No doubt, but the Marcia Blaine School is essentially a conservative school. We do not encourage the progressive attitudes. Now, Miss Brodie, I have noticed a spirit of precocity among your girls, your special girls.
Why, thank you.
Oh.
I am in my prime, and my girls are benefiting from it. I'm proud to think that perhaps my girls are more aware.
Precisely.
To me, education is a leading out. The word education comes from the root X, meaning out, and duco, I lead. To me, education is simply a leading out of what is already there.
I had hoped there might also be a certain amount of putting in.
That would not be education, but intrusion. From the root prefix in, meaning in, and the stem trudo, I thrust. Ergo, to thrust a lot of information into a pupil's head.
To discuss education with such a dedicated teacher is always instructive. However, it was not for that reason that I asked you to come here, Miss Prudy. I am told that you make weekly expeditions to Cramond.
Yes. Isn't it a lovely spot?
It is indeed. I believe Mr. Lowther inherited the estate from his mother. He has lived there all his life. Mr. Lowther is not a worldly man, not a reckless man. It is doubtful whether he would recognize recklessness in others. And recklessness is an indulgence that we at Marcia Blaine must eschew, not only within our walls, but in the personal life, the conduct, as it were, of the teaching staff.
Oh, Miss Mackay, I do not believe I have ever fully appreciated the taxing load of trivia with which a headmistress must concern herself.
I must concern myself, Miss Brodie, with this school's board of governors.
I flatter myself that I am not unknown to the board, having been a member of the staff of Marcia Blaine 6 years prior to your engagement, Miss Mackay. I feel quite safe in saying that no member of the board has ever shown anything but appreciation and approval of my teaching methods. Oh, Miss Mackay, I use the woods of Cramond for lessons in botany, the rocks of the shore to investigate the mysteries of geology. It should be patently clear that my expeditions to Cramond are expeditions for enrichment. Enrichment for my girls. And for Marcia Blaine.
Well, thank you, Miss Brodie. I can assure you and I have come to understand each other better.
Oh, I'm always at your command, Miss Mackay.
I am delighted to hear it. Good day, Miss Brodie.
Oh, chrysanthemums. Such serviceable flowers.
May I have a word with you, Miss Gold? Miss Gould, you are, of course, aware of the problem. When a teacher has tenure and the loyalty of her pupils, it's not going to be easy, Miss Gould. However, no doubt, in due time, some advantage will be vouchsafed us. In the meanwhile, I would deem it a sincere service to the school if any indiscretion that might reach your ear should also reach mine. Also, your brother is a deacon of Cramond Kirk, is he not? And naturally eager to preserve its sanctity. Thank you, Miss Scott.
Your letter has moved me deeply, as you may imagine. But alas, I must ever decline to be Mrs. Lowther. My reasons are twofold. I am dedicated to my girls, as is Madame Pavlova. And there is another in my life. He is Teddy Lloyd. Here, let me think. We can still have many a breezy day in the fishing boat at sea.
What are you two girls up to? Now gather your things together and leave at once. This is a library, not a fun fair. Are those your books?
No, Miss McKenzie.
That you are using the correct length of stitch.
Now, if we were to fill this room with the hydrogen being made in these gas jars, and then strike a match, there'd be an explosion large enough to reduce this building to dust and rubble. Luke, I'll show you.
Hey, Johnny Cope, are you walking yet? Or are your drums a-beating yet? If ye were walking, I would wait. Tig gang to the calls of the morning.
All together now.
Hey, Johnny Cope, are you walking yet? Or are your drums a-beating yet? If ye were walking, I would wait. Tig gang to the calls of the morning.
The sun, forsooth, we are renewed. Refreshment al fresco. Enough to go round, but the lion's share for Mr. Lowther. This terror may have sworn to fatten Mr. Lowther by a full half-stone. That is my pledge. Did I neglect to tell you girls that once, on leave from the war, Hugh took me out sailing in a fishing boat? We spent our happiest times among the rocks and pebbles of a small seaport. Sometimes Hugh would sing. He had a rich tenor voice. At other times, he would set up his easel and paint. Hugh was very talented in both arts, but I think the painter was the real Hugh. But you girls are my life now. I am the potter and you are my pride. You are shaping up. Soon you will graduate to the senior school and I will no longer teach you, but you will always be Brodie girls.
Ah, here comes our Mr. Lowther.
Our minstrel sweet will sing unto me, Randalay, or drop the briny tear with me, da-da-da-da-da-da-da, and like a running river be. Now, oh. Mr. Lowther, you must cooperate with the fattening project. It will enrich your voice. Caruso had the appetite of a giant. La donna mobile.
Good care you take on me.
La 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 la.
I was noticed at the theatre. I was noticed and reported to Mr. Gaunt.
Mr. Gaunt? Oh, that deacon at Cranon. Whatever for?
Well, he considered Hedda gabbler. Well, he said that the choirmaster of his church had no business attending that sort of thing with an unmarried lady and children. Oh, I defended myself. Fiercely.
Well, girls, as you hear, there's now been an attempt to persecute Mr. Lowther on our account. One must never succumb to provincial ignorance. Mr. Lowther did not. Nor shall anyone under my tutelage. Now, eat up, Mr. Lowther. What is it, Sandy?
Miss Mackay is watching us from her window.
Oh, indeed. I wonder how many more picnics we will be allowed before Miss Mackay thinks fit to patrol the grounds. It is Miss Mackay's hope to harass me into leaving Marcia Blaine. Miss Gaunt and certain teachers have taken to bidding me good morning with predestination in their smiles.
Do you really think Miss Mackay wants to drive you away?
It doesn't signify what Miss Mackay wants. Here I am and here I stay. I would not leave you girls for the Lord.
Lion King of Owls.
Not even he. I shall remain in this education factory where my duty lies. If they want to get rid of me, they'll have to... assassinate me. Now, eat up, Mr. Lowther. Cooperation is the keynote. Now, Jenny, do us a cartwheel for comic relief. Bravo! 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 These are my girls, Mr. Lowther. Forsooth, they are broody girls. Monica is histrionic. She will perform in plays or perhaps write them. Mary, our Mary is alone in this world. Her needs are great. But she has me. Mary will stop stuttering. She will brisk up. Mary McGregor will distinguish herself for me. I have no doubt. Then there is Jenny. Sometimes I feel there is a spiritual bond between Jenny and me. I don't expect Jenny feels this yet, but someday she will. And Sandy...
Sandy is dependable.
Oh, Sandy. Sandy is very dependable. Now, Monica, recite for us, please.
What shall I recite, Miss Brodie?
Something. Something of magic.
There she weaves by night and day a magic web with colours gay. She has heard a whisper say a curse is on her if she stayed to look down on Camelot. She knows not what the curse may be.
Mr. Lowther, the Philistines are upon us. She knows not what the curse may be, and so she weaveth steadily. And little other care hath she, the Lady of Shalott. But in her web she still delights to weave the mirror's magic sights. For often through the silent nights, a funeral with plumes and lights and music went to Camelot. Or when the moon was overhead, came two young lovers lately wed. I am half sick of shadows, said the Lady of Shalott.
The Lady of Shalott.
I think perhaps someday Jenny will catch the eye of an artist. Jenny will be painted many times. In years to come, I think that Jenny will be famous for sex.
Well, Monica, what do you think of it?
It makes her look very mature.
I am very mature. We're all mature.
Some people at the school think you're too mature.
Everyone's jealous. They know the Brodie set has more fun than anyone else. We go places and we do things.
And now you've taken to hanging round an artist's studio. Very glamorous.
Miss Brodie's glamorous, don't you think?
Mr. Lowther thinks she is. Sandy's awfully late. Do you think she's coming?
3 years of Cramond and Mr. Lowther. What stamina.
There's always lovely food at Cramond.
Lasagna verde, sweetbreads a la milanaise.
Charlotte Russe.
Charlotte Russe.
Miss Brodie takes good care of Mr. Lowther. What does Mr. Lowther do for Miss Brodie?
He sings to her.
Sandy, where have you spent all this time?
Put that whipping over there. Mary, for the third time this afternoon, will you get out of the way?
Sorry.
Mary MacGregor. Well, Mary, what's new on the Rialto? What's new with your brother? How's he progressing up at Oxford?
His tutor caught fire.
Caught fire? His tutor? How? From what?
From my brother. Your brother set fire to the tutor.
Your brother should be put in a house of correction.
It makes me look very mature.
It makes you look like Miss Brodie. All the sketches of Jenny do too, they all look like Miss Brodie. I think they do.
Ugh!
I painted that chap in my student days. It's what's called a life study. I had a difficult time with the pectoral muscles.
Pectoral?
Chest.
Oh.
Oh, Monica.
What?
Miss Brodie says that anyone of a cultured home and heritage makes no fuss about the human body.
Who's making any fuss?
You are.
I have as much heritage as you do any day.
I think that's enough for today. If I keep on, I shall ruin the mouth. And that would be a pity. What do you think?
Well, I think that it's...
Miss Brodie says that Jenny will be painted many times.
And what does she say about you?
That I am dependable.
When should I come back?
Whenever you have time. Come next Saturday.
All right, come on, Sandy, I'm starving.
No, I can't come with you. I've got to meet my mother.
Oh, your eternal mother.
Goodbye, girls.
Bye, Mr. Lloyd.
Goodbye, Mr. Lloyd.
My feet are wet.
Take your shoes off then, silly. Dry them by the stove. I'll make some tea. No, that's a lot. Not up to Cramond standards, I fear. Lasagna verde, Harlot roots. I wonder all that rich food doesn't give old Lowther a stoppage.
He eats his greens. Do you paint portraits of your own children, too? Your wife?
That's my wife. Her name is Deirdre.
She in her prime?
Perhaps not quite yet. One day I'd like to paint all you Brodie girls. Be interesting to see what sort of group I can make of you.
We'd all look like one great big Brodie, I suppose.
You're a clever little cat, aren't you? That'll teach you to look at an artist like that. Don't you want the rest of your things? Can't have you running through the streets like a wee whore.
Oh, Brody, Mr. Lowther.
Whatever are you doing in this neighbourhood? As you see, Mr. Lowther and I have been shopping for tomorrow's lunch. Oh, thank goodness we can still have our Sunday lunch at Cremond. I can't tell you how much I miss having you girls in my class this year.
We miss you too, Miss Brody.
Tomorrow I must tell you girls of a new plot Miss Mackay has to force me to apply for a post at a progressive, that is to say a crank school. But I shall stay at Marcia Blaine where my duty lies. If they want to get rid of me, they will have to
assassinate.
Precisely. I thought you were to attend some social gathering this afternoon with Janie. Where's Janie?
She went on home ahead of me. I stayed at the studio.
The studio?
Jenny just left, you see.
Mr. Lloyd's studio, whatever were you doing there?
It was supposed to be a surprise. Jenny is sitting for Mr. Lloyd.
Jenny is sitting for Mr. Lloyd. And I wasn't to know when did this begin?
At the start of term. I shouldn't have told you.
Jean.
I'm very glad you did tell me, Sandy. You are developing into a girl of great insight.
Thank you, Miss Brody.
You know, Sandy, I would be very interested to hear your own impressions of Jenny's portrait, but we won't discuss it with the others. So, Monday, after school, you'll come to my flat for tea. We'll have a nice, quiet time together.
Yes, Miss Brody.
Well, here we are. I'm sure Mr. Lowther will take you home.
Yeah.
In you get, Sandy.
Thank you.
Can you manage
yes,
here?
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Gordon.
Very kind.
Oh, you're more than welcome.
It's a painting of Mr. Lloyd's family. It starts with himself and his wife, and then all the children graded downwards to the baby and the dog on the floor. It's supposed to be funny. But the funniest part is they all look like you.
Like me?
Yes. Even the baby. Everybody he paints looks like you.
Ooh.
You shall butter the scones, Sandy dear. Be generous. Does the portrait of Jenny look like me?
Oh, yes. Mr. Lloyd might want to paint me, too.
I doubt if having your portrait painted is going to be your career, Sandy. Would you mind shutting the window, dear? There's a wee bit of a draft.
What do you think it will be, Miss Brody?
What do I think what will be?
My career.
Well, you're quite intelligent, of course. Actually, Sandy, you have something more than mere intelligence. You have insight.
There goes Miss Lockhart.
The chemistry teacher?
Yes, she's got her golf clubs. Monica saw Mr. Lowther playing golf with Miss Lockhart.
Twice. Indeed. Well, I know very little of Miss Lockhart. I leave her to her jars and guesses. We were talking about your insight, Sandy. You do have insight, and Jenny has got instinct. Jenny will be a great lover. She's like a heroine from a novel by Mr. D.H. Lawrence. The common moral code will not apply to her. She will be above it. This is a fact which only someone with your insight should know about. You know, Sandy, you would make an excellent Secret Service agent. A great spy. Sandy, you must try not to peer at people. It makes a most rude impression.
Why do you think I would make a good spy, Miss Brody?
Well, because you are intelligent and not emotional. I've observed this constraint in you. It has from time to time distressed me, as I myself am a deeply emotional woman. I feel many things passionately.
I feel things, Miss Brody.
Well, everybody does, of course. It's simply a matter of degree. Actually, a passion would be a great handicap to a spy.
It would?
Definitely.
What did you mean when you said that Jenny was above the common moral code?
Or simply that it will not apply to her. She is the exception, and we can help Jenny to realize this. Oh, Sandy dear, I forgot the hot water.
I'll get it.
Thank you, dear.
Miss Brodie, how do you think that we can help Jenny?
We can encourage her, give her confidence.
Confidence for what?
When she is 18. With a girl like Jenny, perhaps even 17, soon she will know love. Do you understand that, Sandy?
You mean she'll have affairs? Love affairs?
Oh, Sandy, you do have insight. I am never wrong. I can always depend on you. Little girls, you must all learn to cultivate an expression of composure. It is one of the greatest assets of a woman, an expression of composure, come foul, come fair. Regard the Mona Lisa. She is older than the rocks on which she sits. Whom did I say to regard? Clara.
The Mona Lisa, Miss Brodie.
That is correct. Clara has artistic tendencies. Little girls, I am in the business of putting old heads on young shoulders, and all my pupils are the crème de la crème.
Jean! Oh, Jean!
Miss Lowther!
Jean, Miss Brodie, it's Miss Mackay. I've just left her. I don't know what to do.
Miss Lowther, did you wish to speak to me about something? What can you be up to, Gordon? Such display in front of the children.
But I tell you, it's Miss Mackay. She dismissed my class. She's found something terrible, something incriminating. She demands to see us both together immediately.
I am not accustomed to being summoned immediately. Not by anyone.
But Jean, she sent me to meet you. She said no.
Please, pull yourself together, Gordon. I promise I won't let Miss Mackay stand you in the corner. Just you wait there a minute.
Well, your headmistress, Miss Mackay, wishes to see me for a few minutes. She has a wee problem she wishes to discuss with me. Now, what subject were we doing?
History.
Oh, yes. Well, open your history books. While I'm away from the room, we'll all read the chapter on the succession of the Stuarts. We'll sit quietly in your seats and remain composed, like the Mona Lisa.
Miss Brodie. Do you know what this is?
It would appear to be a piece of blue paper with writing on it in pencil.
It is, in fact, a letter. It was found by Miss Mackenzie in a library book. She glanced at it, but after the first sentence, she dared not actually read it. She brought it instantly to me.
Yes. Is it addressed to you?
No, Miss Brodie. It is addressed to Mr. Lowther, but it is signed by you. I shall begin.
Oh, please do.
Of course, I realize it is a forgery. It is the work of a child. My dear, delightful Gordon, your letter has moved me deeply, as you may imagine. But alas, I must ever decline to be Mrs. Lowther. My reasons are twofold. I am dedicated to my girls, as is Madame Pavlova, and there is another in my life. He is Teddy Lloyd. Intimacy has never taken place with him. He is married to another. We are not lovers, but we know the truth. However, I was proud of giving myself to you when you came and took me in the bracken while the storm raged about us. If I am in a certain condition, I shall place the infant in the care of a worthy shepherd and his wife. I may permit misconduct to occur again from time to time as an outlet, because I am in my prime. We can also have many a breezy day in the fishing boat at sea. We must keep a sharp lookout for Miss Mackay, however, as she is rather narrow, which arises from an ignorance of culture and the Italian scene. I love to hear you singing, Hey Johnny Cope, but were I to receive a proposal of marriage tomorrow from the Lord Lion, King of Arms, I would decline it. Allow me, in conclusion, to congratulate you warmly on your sexual intercourse, as well as your singing, with fondest joy, Jean Brodie. Is this what your girls, Your set has learned under your auspices, Miss Brodie.
It's a literary collaboration. Two separate hands are involved. One of the author's lengths of tail consonants in an unorthodox manner, and the other does not. Also, the paper seems somewhat aged.
Is that all you have to say?
What else is there to say? Two little girls at the age of budding sexual fantasy have concocted a romance for themselves. They've chosen me as a romantic symbol. Is that so surprising?
Do you deny that you encourage these fantasies, as you call them? Do you deny that by consorting openly with Mr. Lowther of Crammond, you lead these poor children into the most fevered conclusions? Not only Mr. Lowther, but Mr. Lloyd is brought into the circle of fire. Mr. Lloyd, who has a wife and six children. It is diabolic that infants should be knowledgeable of...
12-year-old girls are not infants, Miss Mackay.
How do you know they're 12 years old?
From the handwriting, the vocabulary, the rudimentary knowledge of the facts of life. Surely you cannot believe that that is the work of 9-year-olds.
I could believe it was the work of your 9-year-olds, Miss Brodie.
Well, there's very little for me to say, Miss Mackay, in the face of your extraordinary prejudice and hostility.
Miss Brodie, I am not asking you to say anything. I am asking, demanding, that you put your signature, your own signature, on a letter of resignation which I have prepared for you.
I will not resign.
You will not resign. You will force me to dismiss you.
I will not resign, and you will not dismiss me, Miss Mackay. You will not use the excuse of that pathetic, that humorous document to blackmail me. Mr. Lowther, you are a witness to this. Miss Mackay has made totally unsupported accusations against my name and yours. If she has one authentic shred of evidence, just one, let her bring it forth. Otherwise, if one more word of this outrageous calumny reaches my ears, I shall sue. I shall take Miss Mackay to the public courts, and I shall sue the trustees of Marcia Blaine if they support her. I will not stand quietly by and allow myself to be crucified by a woman whose fetid frustration has overcome her judgment. If scandal is to your taste, Miss Mackay, I shall give you a feast.
Miss Brodie,
I am a teacher. I am a teacher first, last, always. Do you imagine that for one instant I will let that be taken from me without a fight? I have dedicated, sacrificed my life to this profession, and I will not stand by like an inky little slacker and watch you rob me of it. And for what? For what reason? For jealousy? Because I have the gift of claiming girls for my own. It is true, I am a strong influence on my girls. I am proud of it. I influence them to be aware of all the possibilities of life. Of beauty, honor, courage. I do not, Miss Mackay, influence them to look for slime where it does not exist. I am going. When my class convenes, my pupils will find me composed and prepared to reveal to them the succession of the Stuarts. And on Sunday, I will go to Crammond to visit Mr. Lowther. We are accustomed, bachelor and spinster, to spend our Sundays together in sailing and walking the beaches and in the pursuit of music. Mr. Lowther is teaching me to play the mandolin. Good day, Miss Mackay.
Mr. Lowther, I'm sure I need not suggest to you that we keep the details of Miss Brodie's little tantrum to ourselves. Oh, I've no doubt that you, as well as I, have her interests at heart.
Well,
thank you, Mr. Lowther. Now, I've no doubt you have other duties to attend to.
Oh, yes, yes, Miss Mackay. Thank you. Thank you very much, Miss Mackay.
Jean! Jean, you were heroic, heroic! Oh, to see you like that, it was really inspiring. If only I could have stood up like that to Mr. Gaunt. If I could have said to him, now look here, Mr. Gaunt, if you have one authentic shred of evidence, just one.
What are you talking about?
Oh, Mr. Gaunt, he called to see me the night before last. He advised me to resign as organist and elder of the church. He spoke very plainly.
And what did you answer?
I resign.
And you allow this evil-minded man, a man who uses his position as deacon of the kirk, to receive the slanderous gossip of petty provincials.
Ah, but gee, it isn't just gossip. You do not go home on Sunday nights.
They had no proof. None whatever. You should have refused point blank to resign. Can't you see that resignation is tantamount to a confession of guilt?
But I feel guilty.
Well, I do not.
Oh, Jean, will you not marry me and put an end to all this sneaking about? Why won't you marry me?
Only yesterday it was told to my face that you are planning to marry the chemistry teacher.
Oh, I played golf with Miss Lockhart once.
Twice.
Twice?
Beware. Don't trifle with her. She has the means to blow us all up.
Now, don't tease me, Jean. Miss Lockhart means nothing to me. Well, you know that all I care about is you. All I want is to see you happy and safe. Oh, I don't understand you, Jean. You will not marry me, and yet you feed me and share my bed.
Share your bed? Why can't you say you are my lover?
I do not want to be your lover. I want to be your husband. I want to go on my honeymoon to the Isle of Egg near Rum, where my mother and father went on their honeymoon. And I want to come back to Cremond with my bride. That's what I want. And I want to conduct a church choir, too.
Are flying. Are you out?
On the contrary, Miss McKay experienced the utmost difficulty in persuading me to stay.
How I wish I might have heard her plea.
The utmost difficulty. You've been painting Jenny.
Yes, that's right.
I am glad, very glad. She's getting more beautiful each year. She quite amazes me. You see it too. You're an artist. You see things other men don't see. You must see it.
Jenny's quite a pretty girl.
Pretty? No, it's much more than that. She has extraordinary physical instincts, primitive and free.
Primitive, little Jen. What are you up to, Jean?
I'm only trying to tell you that I've always felt that Jenny could be magnificently elevated above the ordinary run of lovers.
What are you talking about?
Just that I've always known that one day you would paint Jenny.
Paint Jenny? Jean, I think you're quite aware of what you're doing. You're trying to put that child in my bed, in your place.
Don't be disgusting!
It's only the words that disgust you. You don't boggle at the thought, do you? You'll accept anything but reality, trying to use Jenny and poor old Lowther, making him play house.
I do not use Mr. Lowther. It is I who allow myself to be used. I give him every attention of him. Cook for him.
Feed him instead of loving him, isn't that it?
You know nothing about what there is of love between Gordon and me.
Oh, my God, all those boring hours in bed with old Lowther puffing bravely away. Good, that's more like it. That was direct. That's the first actual contact between us in 3 years.
Get out! Get out! Get out of my class! My girls! Little girls, this is Mr. Lloyd, the art master. When you are 14, if he is still at Marcia Blaine, I will then hand you over to him and you will be fortunate enough to receive his artistic guidance.
Goodbye, girls.
Goodbye, sir.
See you in 3 years. Goodbye, Miss Brody. I also hope I shall see you.
For the rest of the afternoon, I have decided that we will not do more history.
Rather, I will show you some more slides of my last holidays in Italy. Monitors, the blinds, please. Clara, will you pull down the screen? I also spent 2 weeks in Egypt, where people do not believe in God, but in Allah. Catherine, will you switch on the light, please? The bottom left-hand side. I have brought you these slides at my own expense. The girls at the back may sit up on their desks. Rome. This is a large formation of Il Duce's fascisti. They are following him in noble destiny. I myself mingled with such a crowd. I wore my silk dress with red poppies, which is right for my coloring. Benito Mussolini, Il Duce, Italy's leader supreme, a Roman worthy of his heritage, the greatest Roman of them all. The Colosseum, where Christian slaves were thrown to the lions and gladiators fought to the death. Ave imperator morituri te salutamus. Hail Caesar, those who are about to die salute thee. Florence, the David of Michelangelo. That is the original David. He's in the Galleria dell'Accademia di Belle Arti. There is a copy in the Piazza della Signoria, next to the Palazzo Vecchio. He is there for any passerby to gaze upon and be uplifted. He is at once the glory of the past and the inspiration of the future. David, the young warrior. This is a picture of the Ponte Vecchio. The old bridge, Ponte Vecchio. There's a famous painting of Dante meeting Beatrice. It is pronounced Beatrice in Italian, which makes it very beautiful. Meeting Beatrice on the Ponte Vecchio. He fell in love with her at that moment. He was a man in his middle years. She was 14. That can happen. A mature man can find love in a young girl, a very young girl. And in the spring, the essence of all old loves. It is not unlikely, though we shall never know, that Beatrice reminded Dante sharply in that moment when he first saw her. Of an old love, a lost love, a sublime love. And he was seized with such a longing, such a longing. That picture was painted by Rossetti. Who was Dante Gabriele Rossetti, Jenny? Who's Dante Gabriele Rossetti? Clara.
A painter, Miss Brodie.
What was that you said?
A painter.
Yes. Yes, a painter. Oh, yes.
Where you are mistaken is in supposing that Jean Brodie is unique. There's an army of these ladies in Edinburgh. It's simply that they do not attempt to teach in schools of the traditional character of Marcia Blaine. Jean is a magnificent specimen.
She's utterly ridiculous.
There's no contradiction in being both ridiculous and magnificent. Your young mind will have to stretch a bit to grasp that.
I think my young mind is stretched astonishingly to be able to discuss at 17. At 17, the enduring passion of my lover for another woman.
It is not only astonishing, Sandy, it is unnatural. You should be passionate. and involved and short-sighted.
I'm tired.
Take a rest, then. I'll make some tea.
Her and her passions are fascisti. You should see her skulking around the third formers trying to raise funds for Franco.
Franco? Oh, my God.
Oh, yes, we've gone very Spanish this term. What with Mary McGregor's brother and all.
What's Mary McGregor's miserable brother got to do with Franco?
Haven't you heard? He's run off to Spain to fight. Miss Brodie's beside herself with joy.
Jean knows nothing of politics or politicians. She simply invests all leaders with her own romantic vision.
Why isn't there ever anything to eat in this place? You know, it occurred to me that the Brodie set has been Miss Brodie's faithful fascisti marching along. And I suddenly thought of her disapproval of the girl guides. Why, it's simple jealousy. The guides are a rival fascisti, and she cannot bear it. How I wish I'd joined the Brownies.
What a spiteful child it is. You're too irritable for a girl of your age.
My age does bother you, doesn't it? How much longer are you going to be tempted by this firm young flesh?
All till you're 18 and over the hill.
Hey, Teddy, take me dancing.
Certainly not.
What a coward.
A man with a wife and six children, plus a schoolgirl for a mistress, can be called any number of rude names, but coward is not one of them. So sweet, the flesh of the neck. If only it could be bottled and sold across the country.
I really shouldn't feed your depraved appetite. Hey, Teddy, listen. When can I look at my painting? I'm very bored with not being allowed to see my own portrait.
Well, I've finished it, and I shall never finish it. We shall simply go on like this until one or both of us is dead.
Now, I want to see myself mirrored in your eyes. I need a vision of myself.
No, Sandy, no. I haven't finished it yet. I'm not pleased with it yet.
Oh, you. You'll never be pleased.
Sandy! I cannot help myself, Sandy. Believe me, it has nothing to do with what I feel for you.
Even the skin tones are hers. It's not even my skin. And I really thought that you... Well, you know, desired me. Desired me.
I do.
It might just as well have been Jenny after all. It would have been the same with anyone.
Sandy, listen to me. Love is the most irrational thing on God's earth. Do you think I choose to love Jean Brodie? If I could choose, I would love my wife or you. You are the most remarkable girl I've ever known. You are marvelous and astonishing and desirable. Why would I not choose to love you if I could choose? Please don't think less of yourself because I am bewitched.
Very well, I shan't.
Believe what I'm telling you.
Oh, I believe you, Teddy. I even believe that you are bewitched. I'm not sure about God, but I am now quite sure about witches.
Will you be back tomorrow?
No, I won't be back. That really would be a waste of time, wouldn't it? Good night, Teddy. You can go on painting. You don't really need a model. As this seems to be a time for truth, you're quite a mediocre painter, Teddy. You'll never be really good. I wonder you don't try some other line. You are getting on, you know.
Generalissimo Franco is called El Jefe, the chief.
J-E-F-E, the J is silent, El Jefe. He is a dedicated man. You must all grow up to be dedicated women. As Generalissimo Franco has dedicated himself to a cause, as I have dedicated myself to you. Dedication is the order of the day. Oh, Mary McGregor, girls, come and join us. Mary, dear, is there any news from your brother from Spain?
No, Miss Brodie, nothing. Mr. Ealing at the bank is sending for him, sending detectives to Spain.
Your brother is being sent for. Mr. Ealing at the bank would send for Caesar. The Mr. Ealings at the bank have tried throughout history to stay the march of civilization. Why can't they understand? It should be obvious to the meanest intelligence. Franco's army comprises all the best elements of Spain and her supporters. They are committed to heroic action. You little girls are living in a time that will demand all that you have to give of courage and gallantry. You must become heroines. Heroines!
Do you mean we will have to march and shoot guns?
If you are called.
Girls?
Have you never heard of Hannah Snell? She was an English girl born in 1723 and sailed in Admiral Boscawen's fleet and fought at Arapong. She was wounded, but without medical aid, she extracted the bullet from her own shoulder and lived to serve again. Hannah Snell was a girl. Now, you two must be prepared to serve, suffer, and sacrifice. Are you prepared?
Yes, Miss Brodie.
Yes, Miss Brodie.
No, Miss Brodie.
But she could get shot. Without medical aid, she would extract the bullet from her own shoulder and live to serve again.
It isn't funny. She could really get hurt.
What's going on? Who could get hurt?
Mary McGregor. She's run away to Spain to fight.
What kind of joke is this?
Well, it isn't a joke. She's really gone to Spain.
Mary McGregor couldn't negotiate her way across Edinburgh.
Oh, but she has a guiding spirit.
What are you talking about?
I'm sure Miss Brodie gave Mary very explicit directions. The Paris train will take you as far as Perpignan. P-E-R-P-I-G-N-A-N. Now, the pounds are in this envelope marked pounds. And the francs are in this envelope marked francs. And the pesetas are in this envelope marked pesetas. How else?
I don't believe it.
Nor do I. Miss Brodie will be frantic.
Miss Brodie will be ecstatic.
Moving your troops to Barcelona?
Mary McGregor has gone to join her brother. He is her only kin.
Yes, I heard you've been raising funds for Franco. I find that extraordinary.
The times are extraordinary. O'Malley MacGregor. Girls, I have called you together, my special girls, to tell you the truth about Mary MacGregor. Miss Mackay has told you the facts about Mary's death, how the train was bombed and machine-gunned as it crossed the frontier, but only I can tell you the truth. Mary MacGregor died a heroine. It was her intention to fight for Franco against the forces of darkness. So although she was killed before she herself could strike a blow, her intention was a noble and heroic one. Had she lived, Mary would have become a woman of great spirit and initiative. Hers would have been a dedicated life. You must all grow up to be dedicated women, as Mary MacGregor dedicated her youth to a cause, as I have dedicated myself to you. Tonight, little girls, let your imaginations soar. Think of Joan of Arc, Florence Nightingale. Think of Mary MacGregor. Who among you has the makings of a heroine? Yes, Clara.
May we think of you, Miss Brodie?
Well, why not? Deep in most of us is a potential for greatness, or the potential to inspire greatness. The day draws late. Your families will be expecting you. Take home the story of Mary MacGregor. Sandy? I thought you and I might have tea together. I wanted to talk to you about Mary.
I'm sorry, but I have some work to do.
How busy and grown up you've become. Well, I won't try to stop you, but you must remember, Sandy dear, how much I do depend on you.
I'll remember.
Sandy?
No, thank you.
I thought it was considered a triumph of the first magnitude to be asked to dance by a male staff member.
Excuse me.
Mr. Lloyd said I could have my portrait.
Monica.
Oh, thank you, Sandy.
All right,
thank
you very much.
Thank you.
some punch, Miss Brodie.
Oh, Mr. Lovely, thank you. That's very thoughtful of you.
Well, Jean, how's the Franco fund coming along?
Not well. Popular sentiment being what it is, one can hardly plead the cause in the Marcia Blaine Assembly Hall.
Yes, I dare say. I, too, am attempting to raise funds for a worthy cause.
You? What sort of cause?
A romantic one. I'm taking up a collection to buy a wedding present. For Lowther and Miss Lockhart. May I put you down for a pound? It's to be a simple affair at Crammond Kirk a week on Saturday. I'm told when they announced their intention to Miss Mackay last evening, her delight was so profound that she ran amok and toasted them in neat whiskey.
Ah, Miss Brodie.
Oh, good evening, Mr. Burridge. Girls.
Good evening. I've
not seen you dancing yet.
Oh, the night is young, Mr. Burridge. Excuse me for one moment.
Teddy, who told you to come to me like that? Who?
I volunteered. I said the sparrow with my bow and arrow. I volunteered.
And what kill, pray, did you expect to make? Do you think I cannot, with one snap of my fingers, send poor Miss Lockhart back to her gaseous domain? It was I who encouraged Mr. Lowther in his reluctant pursuit of Miss Lockhart. What I cannot understand is you. I cannot understand your malice coming to me in that way, hoping to hurt and humiliate me. Why?
I don't know. It's what I wanted, to hurt you.
Why? Why are you so angry with me?
Because I'm afraid, because I don't feel safe with you around. You should have married old Lowther. You really should. I'm 43 years old, Gina. How old are you?
I'm in my prime.
Your prime. Look at yourself, Jean. Look at me. A second-rate painter running to seed. You're
Teddy,
not
don't...
in your prime, Jean. You're a frustrated spinster taking it out in idiot causes and dangerous ideas. A schoolmarm.
I am a teacher.
A teacher or a leader? The dangerous Miss Brodie and her troops. Well, where you lead, I cannot follow.
Arrivederci.
Mr. Burridge, shall we dance?
Yes, delighted.
Thank you so much.
What about this new one? So, to something that I can promise you is nothing in the name we connected with this particular.
Miss Mackay. Since you were first appointed headmistress of Marcia Blaine, you have done nothing but try to dismiss me from the teaching staff. You have tried every feeble excuse, even that of immorality, and failed. Now you are accusing me of preaching politics to my pupils. Such a continuous personal vendetta is hardly conducive to the dignity of your position.
Miss Brodie, I don't think you quite understand. Let me make the situation perfectly clear. It is not I, but the Board of Governors who have pursued this investigation to its conclusion. And it is the Board of Governors who, after having given due consideration to the grave charges laid against you, have given instructions that you leave this school immediately and that your classes be taken over tomorrow morning by another teacher. The board have asked me to convey to you the fact that your salary will be paid in full until the end of the term, which, in the circumstances, is more than generous. Miss Brodie, there is nothing more to be said.
I shall not accept the board's action. I shall petition. I shall put the question before the public, before the parents and the student body. You will find, Miss Mackay, that I have the loyalty of my girls.
Do you, Miss Brodie?
Miss Brodie, aren't you coming to the common room?
The common room?
The celebration honoring Miss Lockhart and Mr. Lowther. Aren't you coming, Miss Brodie?
I'll be there shortly.
Sandy. Sandy. I believe, Sandy. I believe I am past my prime. I had reckoned on my prime lasting till I was at least 50. Are you listening, Sandy?
I'm listening, Miss Brodie.
I have been dismissed from Marcia Blaine. I am accused of teaching treason and sedition to my students. I am being transported for radicalism, like Thomas Muir of Hunter's Hill. But if Miss Mackay and her conspirators expect that I shall meekly lay my head on their chopping block, they are in for a wee surprise.
What will you do?
As I informed Miss Mackay, I will resort to public petition. I have no doubt that many supporters will rally to my defense. My students are loyal. My girls. Someone betrayed me, Sandy. Someone spoke against me to the board. Who could it have been? Who?
Are you thinking that maybe one of your girls betrayed you?
I said to Miss Mackay, I have the loyalty of my girls. And she said, do you? I'll not believe it. I'll not believe it was one of my girls.
Perhaps it's true.
I thought possibly Monica. There's very little soul
behind. Monica is a loyal girl.
I know. You all are, Monica and Jenny. Oh, not Jenny. She's like a part of myself. You, Sandy, as you see, you are exempt from all suspicion. You have had more of my confidence than anyone. You know more than anyone what I have sacrificed for my girls. Teddy Lloyd was greatly in love with me, Sandy, as I think you have always known. And I gave him up to consecrate my life to the young girls in my care. You and Monica and Jenny. Jenny. She and Mr. Lloyd will soon be lovers. I have that.
Do you think that you are Providence? That you can ordain love?
What?
You haven't pulled it off. Jenny will not be Teddy Lloyd's lover.
What are you saying, Sandy?
Jenny will not be Teddy Lloyd's lover, and I'll not be your spy. Your secret service.
My spy, what on earth are you talking about? Do you understand at all what has happened to me? I have been dismissed from Marcia Blaine. Why are you standing there talking about Providence and the secret service? What is the matter with you?
Miss Brodie, I am Teddy's lover.
What?
I am Teddy's lover.
Teddy's lover? You?
Is that so difficult to believe? What does it matter to you which one of us it is? It doesn't matter to Teddy.
Whatever possessed you? You know his religion. How could a girl with a mind of her own have to do with a man who can't think for himself?
That doesn't seem to have bothered either of us, does it? We were neither of us very interested in his mind.
How dare you speak to me in this manner?
I suppose I've always known that one day you were going to ask, how dare I?
Why, I don't understand. I don't seem to understand what has happened to everyone. Where is everyone gone?
Only Mary is gone.
Mary? What has Mary to do with it?
Miss Brodie, Mary MacGregor is dead. Are you aware of the order of importance in which you place your anxieties? One, you have been betrayed. Two, who is or is not to be your proxy in Teddy Lloyd's bed. And three, Mary's death. Miss Brodie, aren't you concerned at all with Mary's death?
I grieve for Mary.
It was because of you she went.
Because of me, it was her brother. The poor, unfortunate girl hadn't anyone else in the world.
She had you. That was her misfortune. To please you, that silly, stupid girl ran off and got herself killed. Don't you feel responsible for that?
No. No, I feel responsible for giving her ideals. The ideals that sent her to Spain. I feel responsible for teaching her that service to a cause is a privilege.
You call it a privilege to be killed? And for nothing?
Nothing. You really are a shallow girl, Sandy. By the way she died, Mary McGregor illumined her life. She died a heroine.
She died a fool. Joining her brother to fight for Franco, wasn't that just like Mary? Her brother is fighting for the other side.
Her brother
is fighting for the Republicans. Mary was headed for the wrong army.
Oh, Mary McGregor.
Mary McGregor. I used to wonder why I always called Mary by her full name. I think it was because you had such a hard time remembering who she was. Poor dim Mary.
I was devoted to Mary.
No, you were only attracted to Mary because she had no one else and she was so totally suggestible. She appealed to your vanity.
It was you who betrayed me.
I didn't betray you. I simply put a stop to you.
Oh. I see.
No, you don't see. You don't see that you're not good for people.
In what way?
In what way, Sandy, was I not good for you?
You are dangerous and unwholesome, and children should not be exposed to you.
How can you think it? How can you think that I would harm you?
But you have. You have harmed me.
How?
You have murdered Mary.
You have assassinated me.
Oh, why must you always strike attitudes? You really are a ridiculous woman.
What will you do? No.
Do? I don't know. But I am a descendant, do not forget, of Willie Brodie. He was a man of substance, a cabinet maker and a designer of gibbets, a member of the town council of Edinburgh, the keeper of two mistresses who bore him 5 children between them. Blood tells. He played much dice and fighting cocks. Eventually, he was a wanted man for having robbed the excise office. Not that he needed the money. He was a burglar for the sake of the danger. He died cheerfully on a gibbet of his own devising in 1788. That is the stuff I am made of.
I knew you would rise like a phoenix. I'm glad I shall not have to worry about you.
No, I expect that is to be your gift, Sandy, to kill without concern. It is you who are dangerous. You see yourself as a conqueror, don't you, Sandy? Kaiserian in all his beauty rare.
But you profess to be a great admirer of conquerors. Goodbye, Miss Brodie.
To those senior girls who are leaving Marcia Blaine for the last time. You girls are about to take your place in a larger, more demanding world. In this world, you will be called upon to make many moral decisions, affecting not only your own lives, but the lives of your families, your friends, your acquaintances. We are confident, truly confident, that the training you have received here in this school will have equipped you to face life's quandaries with courage and character. For here at Marcia Blake, we have done our best to nurture the virtuous woman, for her price is far above rubies. Let us pray.
Little girls, I am in the business of putting old heads on young shoulders, and all my pupils are the creme de la creme. Give me a girl at an impressionable age, and she is mine for life.
Jean, Jean, the roses are red, all the leaves have gone green, and the clouds are so low, you can touch them, so come out to the meadow, Jean. Jean, Jean, you're young and alive, come out of your half-dream dream, and run if you will to the top of the hill, open your arms, Bonnie Jean.